Welcome to episode 65 of VIVA Physical Media. It's been a while. We've been on a little hiatus.
You guys have been away.
We've been away. Yeah. It's been busy.
Yeah.
Me and Rich and Kevin were at Fantastic Fest.
How was that?
It was good. I only went for the second half because I just, someday I'll go for the whole thing. But saw some good stuff. Saw the new Saw, which apparently everyone loves and I don't. So now the tables have turned.
It's usually the other way around.
Yeah. So I'm a little bamboozled about that, but whatever. Me and Kevin saw a dog movie called Project Silence that we had a lot of fun with it. We put our reviews up on our Twitter/X account if you want to go back and see what we thought. I saw this movie called Falling Stars that I really liked. Kind of reminded me
of
The Vast of Night. It's just like a story about three brothers that go with their friend to dig up a body of a witch.
We weren't there for very long. Less than 5 minutes, right?
And then what?
Like you do.
Like you do. It was really good. A movie called Crumb Catcher that I really liked.
Crumb Catcher?
Yeah, about this guy who...
It's about a machine that you put outside of your table at a restaurant, and you could swip your crumbs into it.
So the waiters don't bother you.
It's also a thriller.
Wow.
It's also about this guy who's pitching this to this unsuspecting couple the night after their wedding in the middle of the night.
Okay.
Sounds goofy. I literally was at the edge of my seat. I was sitting next to Rich. He saw me. I was like, I couldn't look away.
Yeah. Come on, Ellie. Speak your piece.
Well, I guess I don't understand why the customer would want to sweep up their own crumbs.
The new Blumhouse, totally killer, 80s, kind of like Happy Death Day vibe movie. I just loved. I thought it was a lot of fun.
Just think, maybe if she did do blowjobs, she'd still be alive.
Yeah, let's not make that the lesson.
And some other stuff. And Rich, do you have anything you want to shout out now?
Did you see Strange Darling?
No, but people are telling me I missed it.
So good.
Kev said that was good too, yeah. And shot by Giovanni Ribisi.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Horror movie, just straight up horror movie from the director of Terrified, When Evil Lurks.
Oh yeah, I've heard a lot of good things about that.
Super good.
Tenemos que encontrar a la bestia. Antes de que nazcan más. Los tiempos de la fe. Se terminan rápido.
Did anyone see Kill?
Yeah.
I really want to see that.
I like it a lot, which is basically like the raid on a train.
That's what I've heard, yeah. Sounds great.
With a lot of heart, and it's really good.
Like hearts like ripped out of people, or like?
Heart that actually has a story.
Oh, okay.
I wish it was both.
No, it's bloody. It's real gory.
Okay, good. I really want to see that.
I saw the Bleeding Skull Restoration of Blonde Death.
Hi, this is me, Tammy Lynn Bieberdorf, and these are my memoirs, in case we don't get out of here alive. I guess you know who I am by now since my name is all over the TV. But since everything they're saying about us is a pack of lies, I'd like to take this chance to set the record straight.
Oh, one of my favorite movies.
Looked amazing. It looked amazing, and it was fantastic.
She's a real, genuine, three-dimensional human being.
Elbow room, I need spaceman, that ain't all. Yeah, I'm first thing you know.
Would you want to die standing up on a roller coaster?
Yes, yes. And then I saw The Restoration of Nowhere, which I know you're not an Iraqi guy, but...
But I haven't seen that one.
It's fantastic, and I feel like it pairs well with Blonde Death in terms of dialogue and the general ennui of being a young, going-nowhere-fast type individual.
Hence the title.
Life is so complicated. James Duval, Christina Applegate, Nathan Bexton, Rachel True, Jason Simmons, Kathleen Robertson, Jeremy Jordan, Heather Graham, Trey Grayson Lords, and John Ritter.
It was a blast. It was a lot of fun.
We've got some housekeeping to take care of.
We've got a lot of housekeeping. It's October now.
It's October now.
We made it here.
So, what do we got? First of all, behind us, you see the Halloween section. So come in and rent some scary movies. It's spooky times, we've got you covered.
We do.
It's also Scarecrowber.
Scarecrowber.
And that means that you can go to the Egyptian at SIFF, if you're a Seattleite, and see all these great movies that we've programmed for the entire month of October.
The staff has picked movies to program, and some of us will be introing it. Matt just introed Bram Stoker's Dracula.
And I will be doing it again, but not by the time you see this.
Right.
It's possible that as you're watching this right now, that tonight.
This very night.
Saturday night, you will get to go see us, Emily and I.
And Rich.
And Rich introduce Cujo. Yeah. The Egyptian.
Yes, and there's going to be like prizes and like trivia and like, I don't know, just fun hanging out stuff.
It's going to be awesome.
We're going to probably maybe hang out afterwards.
Maybe. On the 20th, I want to say, the unstreamable folks, Jazz and Chase, are going to be showing Near Dark in 35 millimeter.
Dude.
Unmissable.
I want to grab that.
Unstreamable, unmissable.
By grab that, I mean get a ticket. I want to grab that.
I'm going to grab it.
I'm going to grab that.
Grab it, bite it, suck it dry.
I'm introing Carnival of Souls, but I don't remember what day it is. But you can look up on SIFF, if you just search Scarecrowber or SIFF Scarecrow or whatever, you'll find the page with all of the movies. It's going to be such a fun month.
Yes.
Like, so many, like, GI is doing great programming this month. Beacon's doing great programming. It's just a really fun month for horror lovers.
It's movie month.
You know?
Like, everybody loves the movies in October.
Yeah.
Also, by the way, Carnival of Souls, one of my all-time favorite films.
Yes, I think I talked about it last Halloween episode.
Mm-hmm.
So go back and see what I had to say about that.
People, there is a subset of cinephiles that think that movie is like a corny joke.
Mm-mm.
It's one of the scariest movies ever made.
It's a dream.
Foundational
dude.
David Lynch text.
Oh yeah.
If you're into the works of one David Lynch. Anyway,
it's gonna look gorgeous
great
on
choice.
The screen. Oh my
Just
god.
Just wanted to say that.
Thank you. We're doing the
membership drive.
Membership drive.
Huge membership drive in October. We want to get 100 $100 memberships by the end of the month, or by Halloween. You get all kinds of great deals, discounts, maybe some free rentals.
Sneak previews on sales. Different
special events. All kinds of great stuff.
Yeah.
You really support Scarecrow with a membership, especially a good idea if you can't come into the store but want to support us anyway. You know, maybe you rent by mail. Memberships are a great way to supplement that.
I'm pretty
that.
Sure you could gift someone a membership too.
You absolutely can.
Which
and
is like,
should.
What an awesome idea.
What an
to
awesome
To gift
idea.
Someone a membership at Scarecrow if they're a film lover. Like, they don't even have to live here. It's just.
Yes.
Yeah, and we rent by mail, as you said. It's great. It's great. You
absolutely do it.
This month we're doing the Psycho Challenge that Jensen always does. We're about halfway through it now when this comes out, but we're going to hit on that a little bit later with some recommendations for the end of the month.
And if you don't know what the Psycho Challenge is, it's like prompts for every day of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Different categories of movies, so you have something to watch every day in spooky times.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we have a huge day coming up.
Video Store Day, October the 21st. Yeah. Saturday, October the 21st. We're going to have sales in the store. We're going to have music in the store. We're going to have all kinds of great prizes, giveaways. You and I are going to be doing the usual live stream on YouTube, 12 to 6 p.m.
We're going
to
have a dog photo booth.
Dog photo booth. Bring your dog in costume. Take a picture.
Oh, my gosh.
There's going to be so much great stuff going on.
It's going to be a party.
Scarecrow's biggest day of the year.
Yeah, it's going to be a big party. You can't miss it.
If you can't make it to the store in person, watch us on YouTube.
Give
we'll
us
be
a little
doing
shout
some good
out.
Stuff.
We'll read out that. You know?
We will read out your, if you make a donation, we'll read out your message on the air.
That's going to be fun. Is there anything else? I mean, our website's up and going. Our new website's up and going.
Yep. It's looking really good. It's helping a lot of people out.
Yeah.
It's you know, there are things we could fix. There are things that could be done better.
We're growing.
We're working on that.
We're growing together.
Growing pains. The bones are cracking. We're doing a good job.
The bones are cracking. The corpses are rising.
Yes.
Can I tell you a funny story about my brother? He doesn't watch this, so I can embarrass him. For a long time, he thought that at baseball games and sporting events, when they did the wave, he thought that they were that they called it the grave. He thought it was called the grave. And so he thought when people were doing this, they were pretending to be zombies getting out of the fucking grave.
That's awesome.
Up until like 5 years ago.
Good for Matt Soderbergh.
Wow.
I think that was all our housekeeping.
Yeah.
Let's get into this episode.
Episode 6-5.
That's right.
Mailbag.
beautiful. We don't have that many mailbags, but that's all right.
We have some.
We have some. We have a few. You can send us mail at viva@scarecrow.com, or you can send us real physical mail at
5030 Roosevelt Way, Northeast, Seattle, Washington, 98105.
Or you can march your buns to the store and hand us a letter yourself.
Well, that would be nice.
Wouldn't that be something?
A blue letter.
Blue letter!
It's the blue letter! They're bringing down a blue letter!
We have some mailbags here. We got some mailbags here.
Bags of mail.
We got two from Troy.
Two from Troy?
It's been a while.
Double Troy. Yeah,
Double Troy?
Because we did
Double
it.
Troible?
Double Troible. This one's from September 4th, so this is like a month ago. It's been a while, you guys. Hi, Viva crew. If you're running low on dog movies to watch, which we're not.
We're not.
I wonder if you've considered movies where a man does dog cosplay. I randomly came across this movie and of course thought of you all. I don't think there's a real dog, but there is a guy in a dog costume who acts like a dog, and it's a horror movie. Woman goes on a date with hunky millionaire type. At dinner at his place, she meets his roommate slash slave who dresses up and acts like a dog, and the hot date plays along like this is normal. I haven't seen it yet, but would on your recommendation. it's called Good Boy from 2022. I've heard about this around. I don't know if it was at a festival
around
or something. Around the way. Mm-hmm. And I also heard about it on, I think I heard it either on Pure Cinema podcast or Colors of the Dark podcast. They talked about it. And I would be interested in seeing it. It isn't out on physical release yet. I don't think it's streaming, but it looks kind of weird. I mean, clearly.
I would watch anything minutely dog related if it fit, you know, sort of fit the category.
Like, I don't know how I feel. Stuff. I mean, I would watch this, but I don't know how I would feel about it being a dog movie, you know?
I mean, I feel like it's execution dependent. You know, we watch the movie thinking it might be a good dog movie. And maybe it is or maybe it isn't.
Like Dog on Love, where we thought it would be about a dog and it was about...
And there's barely a dog.
That movie was so weird.
Maybe it comes down to...
Don't, like, look, leave Sophia alone. It wasn't her fault.
Sophia, why?
Maybe it should come down to, like, how good of a dog is he? Does he actually do good dog things?
That's true.
Yeah, but I like bad boy dogs, too.
Well, he could be a bad dog, too.
I don't know. But I'm interested... Again. I know, any excuse. Yeah. I mean, honestly... Would love to, and we have been talking about perhaps doing another bingo showing.
James Cameron walks into the boardroom to the whiteboard, writes bingo, writes an S, turns it into a dollar sign.
Bingos. Coincidentally, we just watched Rancho Deluxe 1975 in memoriam for Jimmy Buffett, and it features a scene with young Jeff Bridges himself donning a dog mask for some loud puppy play. That was the best sentence I've ever read.
Now I'm aroused.
Might make a good double feature. And seriously, Rancho Deluxe was a fantastic watch. Small-time crooks slash losers hangout movie featuring the best and most suspenseful game of Pong ever committed to film between Bridges and Harry Dean Stanton.
Hello.
I've never seen this. Have you? It sounds like something you've seen.
I've seen it a long time ago, but it's been it's been like 25 years.
You really should see this, even if not for the dog feature. I love Sad Dad Dean.
There's basically no way a movie with Harry Dean Stanton is all bad.
No. I wonder how many cigarettes he smokes in it. Because the more cigarettes he smokes, the better the movie. Yeah. Montana never looked more beautiful. Let Kevin know about Montana. Okay. Troy in SF.
I don't think Kevin knows about Montana.
We have to let him know. I want to see Rancho Deluxe. Sounds good.
I know where you can rent it.
Where?
Here.
I'm just kidding. Thank you, Troy.
Hey, Scarecrow. I saw that SuperYaki, a movie merch company that you may already know about. Yes, we do. Made a physical media shirt that I thought looked like it could be Scarecrow merch already.
There's another.
Yeah, this actually does look like something we would do.
I'd wear the shit out of this. Actually, the social media lady for SuperYaki was at Fantastic Fest, and she stopped me on the street because I was wearing my nominate Toni Collette Hugh Howard shirt. And I got on their Instagram. That shirt's awesome. Please,
thank you, Elena.
Always feel free to forward us cool shirts you think we would like, because...
Or just buy them for us and send them to us.
But also, you don't have to buy them. You can just...
No, you do.
But you can. But you don't have to. Thanks, Elena.
You do. Buy them.
Okay, we got...
One more from Troy.
Hey, guys. I hope you are enjoying your Psychotronic October. Just a quick note to let you know that thanks to one of your old recommendations that lived in our watch list, my partner and I finally watched the movie Friday. I love that it was due to us, too.
Like one of the most famous movies.
I think you had mentioned it as a good stoner comedy. I love that Troy, that you wouldn't have watched this movie without our recommendation. That's so insane.
Thank you, Troy.
Anyway, there's a scene where the dad is watching Man's Best Friend on TV. I don't even remember that this happened.
Outrun the dog. Run. Go for the tree, Mr. Postman. Go. Huh? Give me a glass of water.
It's your ass, Mr. Postman.
It made us laugh, and I was about to write to you to suggest it for a dog movie, but my partner said it sure looked familiar. Let's look it up. Maybe they already covered it. Yep, episode 2, baby. Now that Zardoz project is done, it might be fun for the best programmer there to create a 7 Degrees of Viva project online. Best, Troy and SF. Sorry to break it to you, Troy, but there are no good programmers
Not our domain.
This team.
You know that learn to code thing where they're like, where I'm like, oh, I don't make enough money. And they're like, learn to code. But we didn't.
No.
Maybe we should find some space here for just a Viva Dog movie, because we had one a little while ago, but, you know, there's more now.
Yeah.
Viva Dog movie section.
We had a Viva. It was episode 1 to like 35 or something. Yeah. So it's almost time for a new one.
Well,
but
wait till we get to 70. We'll do another. Another 35 episodes.
Let's wait till we get to 69.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say.
Yeah. So every funny. Episode nice. After 69 is 69.
Yeah.
69.1. 69.2.
69.31 is 100.
Very nice. Very good, Matt.
Very nice.
Very nice. Thanks, Troy.
Thank you, Troy.
That's our mailbag, and you guys know where to find us if you want to send us any more mail.
Viva I'm not
Scarecrow,
saying it again.
And the address that Matt said earlier, and all the links below.
Mailbag.
It's been a really long time, but I'm back with some results.
Oh.
And the results are for our The results are for our last Raunch v. Rom.
Who won?
Well, do you remember even the movies?
I did the proposal.
You did the proposal, and I did Getting It On. Getting It On had 3 votes. The proposal had 5.
That's right, baby.
The proposal was the winner.
Quintessential rom.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Now we're back with another round.
You ready to go? You ready to do this?
Yeah, in my corner of the ring is Getting Lucky.
He's looking at this girl's butt.
1989, year of my birth. Michael Paul Gerard.
Middlevale High has cheerleaders, jocks, nerds, and a leprechaun. Okay.
All right, who's in your corner?
I have.
Who's coming up against this guy?
Down with Love.
Ooh. All right. Okay. Okay, if you guys don't remember the rules, we each get 2 minutes to kind of just ramble on about our Raunch or our Rom. And then at the end, we get a closing statement. And then you, the viewer, will vote. And yeah, that's Raunch v. Rom.
3, 2, 1, go!
All right, this movie is about a nerdy teenager who really wants to score with this hot cheerleader at his high school. And he ends up, when he's recycling, because that's what nerds do, he ends up finding a leprechaun in a beer bottle. And the guy's like, I'll give you 3 wishes. So basically this leprechaun helps this kid try to have sex and go on dates with this cheerleader who's busy dating like the jerk jock at the high school.
Jerk jock. Shake Shack.
He is also the towel boy for the boys' basketball team.
The main guy is.
Yeah, which means he has to pick up all the sweaty towels.
Just like Clark Kent.
Which is weird because this is the second teen basketball leprechaun movie I've seen. There's one, a Disney original called Luck of the Irish, I believe it has to do with that. Anyways, there's a foreign exchange student from France who's what wet dreams are made of. There's lots of extended sex scenes. You see boobs, nipples, boobs and nipples, and vaginas.
Really? Is there any hanging? Is there any hanging dong?
And there's one. There's one scene where the leprechaun accidentally shrinks our main nerd dude, and he falls into the underwear of the girl that he wants.
God. So there's vore.
So there's a shot. There's a scene where he's like holding on to. They like built this set that looks like pubic hair ropes that he's like holding on to as she's like doing her cheerleading and everything. It's actually pretty insane.
I've got to see this.
Oh my God. There's a guy on a skateboard who plays a saxophone. There's just random ass shit in this movie. And, anyways, I really don't know what to say besides that this is a leprechaun.
It's so raunchy that it confounded you.
Trauma distributed it. It's a leprechaun raunch granting a high school nerd three wishes in order to fuck the cheerleader of his dreams.
Ding, ding, ding.
3, 2, 1, go.
Okay, my movie is called Down With Love. It's 2003 from Peyton Reed. This movie is amazing and still kind of underseen. It is an homage to the sexless sex comedies of the 60s, predominantly starring actors like Rock Hudson and Doris Day. Mm. It's a musical, it's an homage, it's a complete a sort of aesthetic experiment. Renee Zellweger plays Barbara Novak. She's an up-and-coming writer. She's written a book called Down With Love about how women need to stop thinking of themselves as people who need to get married to have a fulfilling life with a husband and start having casual sex.
Yeah.
The publishing company wants her to sort of do a publicity stunt and hook up with, or not hook up with, but like have an interaction with this other famous writer, Ewan McGregor, who plays a guy named Catcher Block. He's a notorious ladies' man. And so they sort of have some back and forth. You know, there's will they or won't they? There's a lot of friction. And eventually they do start to form a relationship. Now, there's a huge twist at the end of this movie that I won't reveal, but this film does a really interesting job of taking a lot of the tropes and aesthetic ideas of these 60s romantic and sort of sexless sex comedies and turning them on their head and making them, for their time, a relatively feminist spin. Also, there's a tremendous cast here. The production design is amazing. It's a musical. There are fun songs. There's dancing, beautiful costumes, all this wonderful stuff. It's directed by the great Peyton Reed, who did Bring It On. He's since graduated to Ant-Man movies. I like the Ant-Mans, but that's neither here nor there. One of the few Ewan McGregor performances from this time that I really like, you know, sort of in between Star Wars movies. And Renee Zellweger is terrific in it. There's absolutely nothing like this out there. It's anomalous and strange and really needs to be checked out by everybody.
Sounds good. Good job, Matt. That was great. So now we will conclude with our closing statements.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go first with Getting Lucky. The cherry on top of this movie was when me and Nick were watching the end credits and we started noticing funny names. And they did it on purpose because we have a Harry Balzac, we have a Cleo Torres, and we have a Guru Ram a Corn Cob Up Your Butt.
Say again.
Guru Ram a Corn Cob Up Your Butt.
Guru,
Ram a Corn Cob Up Your Butt.
Wow. That's nice. I like that. That's good
among
thinking.
Among others.
Is that the AD? Or the
It was the spiritual guidance.
He was the DP.
Consultant.
He was the DP.
So that was fun because I was like, oh man, that guy's name is Harry Balzac. That must suck. And then I kept reading.
Yeah, you don't want it. It sucks to be a Harry Balzac.
And then I kept reading and I was like, wait a minute. They're doing it on purpose. And I just thought it was a delight. So Getting Lucky. It wasn't one of the worst ones I've watched.
My follow-up, my closing argument is that this, of the two movies, is the only one that has a Tony Randall cameo. Take that.
Who's Tony Randall?
Only two people have ever finished the whole thing.
Exactly.
Cut.
So here's to Bannerhouse's new number one author and our new number one editor. Say cheers, everyone.
Cheers.
All right, guys. So as you may have heard earlier, if you were listening to our show.
And you better have been.
We're about halfway through the Scarecrow Video Annual Psychotronic Challenge, where every day, read a prompt for the day, you pick a movie to watch, and then if you feel like it, you share what you've been watching with us using our hashtag SCV Psychochallenge hashtag on social media.
Good work.
Thank you. So we know it's halfway over, but we decided to give you just a few recs each for some of the
And like recs and effects.
What
shake them up, shake them up, shake them.
So okay. Let's start with our Ozploitation.
Okay, you go first.
That's day 16, Ozploitation. Maximize your wander with some thunder from down yonder. If you don't know, Ozploitation is Australian movies. Mm-hmm. And I love Australian horror, by the way. And the one I chose is The Loved Ones, which is one of my favorites. And it's a really fun movie, as you can tell from the cover, about this girl who really wants this boy to go to prom with her, and she will do anything to get him to go to prom with her, and her dad will help.
And indeed he does.
And indeed he does. It's really fucked up, really bloody, a lot of fun. Check it out if you haven't. The director also did a movie called Devil's Candy that I really like as well.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Definitely one of my faves. Check it out.
I also did Ozblo, and I did a movie called The Long Weekend,
which is
about a couple that goes for a weekend in the country, and they are beset on all sides by the tyranny of many, many crazy animals. And they are trapped in some existential nightmare of their own doing.
Camping gong.
While nature rebels against humanity in all of its forms. The Long Weekend. Excellent film.
Check it out. Day 23, vacancy. Road weary are we? Pull over for one that's set at a hotel or a motel.
By the way, named after the movie Vacancy.
Which is
a really great choice for this.
You can hear us talk about that movie
on the Suspense is Killing.
Yeah,
but Vacancy, lots of fun.
Yeah. I chose for Vacancy this horror anthology movie called Southbound that I really like.
Good stuff.
And I haven't seen it in a few years. I really want to rewatch it, but what stuck out to me was the segment. I guess it starts at a hotel. The segment before takes place at the hotel, and the segment after, which is what I'm thinking of with the girls from the band, starts at the motel. They go and then they kind of have to stay at a house.
Ugh. Of course we get a flat.
Guys, car!
Why don't you come to our place?
This place feels like a bad acid trip.
Guys, we have got to go.
I'm not going anywhere.
This movie is great because it does take place in a lot of those kind of places. There's like an abandoned hospital. There's a lot of like stuff on the road. It's that kind of movie. And I think it's one of the better recent horror anthologies out there.
You know who plays the father at the house?
I don't remember.
It's Dana Gould.
Ooh.
Wait, who's that?
Surprising, like, stand-up comedian of the 80s.
Head writer at The Simpsons for years.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Don Knotts impersonator.
It's a good one, and I was like, oh, I'll take it home tonight. Someone hasn't rented out. But that's good. That means you guys are out there watching it. So
I've been looking at you through the window, Larry. Is this Don Knotts?
How would you like to be so famous that you were a prisoner of your own voice? Don Knotts. Very likable man, extremely talented man. He can't make obscene phone calls. He might want to. He might be up at 4 a.m. in a dirty bathrobe.
Well, I've been looking at you through the bedroom window.
Is this Don Knotts?
Classic.
Yep.
All right, what do you have for Vacancy?
For Vacancy, I have a very unusual movie that also we covered on Sick U called Identity.
It was an accident. We had an accident.
And we got stuck, and we couldn't get out. We couldn't get out because of the storm.
Directed by James Mangold, the director of Logan and Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. Don't watch that.
Ray Liotta, John Cusack, Amanda Pete.
This movie is deeply silly, so much fun. Takes place in an abandoned motel. Great, great film. Lots of fun. 90 minutes in and out. Super funny. Great stuff. Identity.
If you want another Vacancy John Cusack movie, I really like 1408. Yeah. I think it's really creepy.
It's so fucking good.
I think it's underseen and underrated, and it really got under my skin when I watched it.
It's an evil fucking room.
So that's another one.
I told someone today to watch that movie.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right, my next one is day 24. Stop and shop. The supermarket just became a shop of horrors. Clean up on aisle 24. And for that one, I chose Intruder.
How could you not?
How could you not? This movie literally takes place in a supermarket. I don't want to like talk too much about it, but it's a super gory, fucked up intruder in a grocery store thing.
Written and directed by Scott Spiegel, who co-wrote Evil Dead 2.
Yes.
Bruce Campbell cameo.
Bruce Campbell cameo. Yeah. Is Raimi involved in this at all?
Maybe Ted Raimi.
Ted is, yeah. No, Sam's in it. Yep.
He's the other cop, right?
Yeah, he's the other cop.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, this one's another really fun, really good one. This is like a good time, capital G, capital T.
You want to have some people over for a funny horror movie that's also a good horror movie, this is your Huckleberry.
For sure. From the producer of Inglourious Bastards and Pulp Fiction.
That's right, Lawrence Bender.
Here we go. And what was your third one?
My one was for Unaccompanied Minors.
Day 19. Danger, stay out of mine shafts or else.
This movie is called The Severed Arm, which is a very, very small movie that not too many people have seen. More of a mystery thriller than anything else.
I love the cover of this.
The mystery is not particularly confounding, but, you know, some guys go into a cave, a mine, and some bad shit happens, and then it triggers a decades-long campaign of revenge. Good stuff.
Love it.
Very lo-fi, very cheap, very chilling. Good stuff. The Severed Arm.
So yeah, those are just a few recommendations we have for the Psycho Challenge. Show Scarecrow what you've been watching using hashtag SCV Psycho Challenge. I love seeing what people are watching. I also love seeing people's like home entertainment setups.
I'm kind of a creep.
I'm like, what are you watching? Like, how do you got it set up over there?
Holy, nice apartment.
Yeah.
Like, what do you pay for that place?
You got some like Halloween lights up, like cute candles. Okay. I will be watching your social media. So...
Spooky.
Psycho Challenge Rex complete.
I'm just crazy about this store.
Don't know if you guys noticed, but I got a new notebook because I filled up my last one with notes about movies. A new book. My movie I'm going to talk about, the first one I'm going to talk about is The Bad Batch. ...2016, directed by Anna Lily Amirpour. You may know her as the director of A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night, which I absolutely loved. This one I put off for a while because I just wasn't sure what it was. This movie, not a lot of people like it, but some people really like it, and I really like it. It really just hit for me. It was a win. There's not a lot of dialogue in this. It's a very slow-paced, post-apocalyptic movie about this girl named Arlen, played by Suki Waterhouse, who is also an incredible singer. If you haven't heard her music, you should look her up. She is exiled into a unregistered stretch of desert that doesn't fall under US or any other country's laws or regulations.
Whew, get me back to that AC.
And it's because she was a prisoner, and people who are exiled to the space are called the Bad Batch, and you're kind of just out of society, basically. But because you're exiled into this desert wasteland, of course you're going to create your own societies within it. So it's kind of her traveling and trying to survive through these things. We're almost immediately met with a scene of her getting attacked by a bunch of cannibals, and there's a great fucking scene. She's knocked out, and she wakes up, and... Ace of Base's All That She Wants is playing. While someone's trying to cut off and does succeed in cutting off her leg and her arm. And I was like, okay, I'm in. She moves around on a skateboard. She eventually settles into this kind of neutral territory called Comfort, where they just have raves all the time, and they take acid, and they worship their cult leader, Keanu Reeves.
This here is the Bad Batch. We ain't good. We're bad.
Who is called the Dream. And
what the Dream inside you.
Yeah, there's women who are like part of his like harem who are walking around being like, the Dream is inside me, and they're pregnant. She just kind of like hangs out there. She ends up taking this young girl under her wing, but then she loses her at a rave. And you know who else is looking for that girl? Jason Momoa, who is also called Miami Man. And he has a big tattoo that says Miami Man across his
chest. The original Jason Momoa mega performance, by the way.
Dude, he's so good in this.
They woman over there. There was a kid was with her. Did you see this kid?
He's great. Everyone's so extra in this, and it's for such like a sparsely like diet. There's not a lot of conversation in this. It's just, it's over the top with its images and this world building that she does within this movie. And I think that's kind of what makes people either love it or hate it. So basically the second half of this movie is Jason Momoa being like, you have to find who ends up being his daughter, this young girl who she loses and who is just kind of being held, not hostage, but just being held in the harem of the dream. It's like a post-apocalyptic Western, really weird, really cool world building, very psychedelic, kind of tonally all over the place, very chaotic, but it just, for some reason, it really just worked with me. Mm-hmm. And I'd say if you're feeling adventurous, try it out. If you liked her other movie, it's definitely not that. it's very much not that, but this makes me really interested to see. And this was 2016, so I actually haven't looked up if she's done anything. Do you know off the top of your head if she has?
Yeah, she has, but I haven't seen it.
Yeah. But yeah,
you,
Bad Batch.
You didn't mention the Jim Carrey cameo.
Okay. Who was Jim Carrey in it?
He's the hobo with the shopping cart.
Oh, my God. And then also Giovanni Ribisi's in it, too.
Giovanni Ribisi.
It's like, just like that.
Yeah.
I think this is a cool, weird-ass movie. And if you haven't seen it and feel like watching something like this, I'd say do it.
My first movie is, I'm gonna preface this a little bit.
Okay, set the scene.
There's been a lot of talk this summer about a little movie called Oppenheimer.
Mm.
About a man.
More like Floppenheimer. Just kidding, it did really well.
It did really well. But I am notoriously at this point on record as not having really liked that movie very much.
Really.
That's neither here nor there. All I'm gonna say is there was a previous film from about a decade ago by a master filmmaker about a man who built weapons for war and regretted what his inventions were used for. And it is so much more beautiful, so much more formally accomplished, and was made by one of the greatest filmmakers of all time. And it's called The Wind Rises. Hayao Miyazaki's The Wind Rises. This is about the man who designed the Zero bomber that Japan flew during World War II.
挨拶! 堀越です! よろしくお願いします!
仕事に帰りたまえ!
はい!
And it is a million times more interesting, in my opinion, than Oppenheimer. And I'm not going to spend the rest of this segment comparing the two films, because I just don't think that there's any real point to that. All I'm going to say is, this takes a very different direction.
Mm.
This movie spends most of its energy on this man's dreams of the beauty and the potential of what he was making.
Caproni-san, 質問があります. 近眼でも飛行機の設計はできますか? 僕は近眼で飛行機の操縦ができません。
いいかね? 日本の少年よ。
All he cared about was, or all this character, I'm not sure how much he actually relates to the real man. All this guy thinks about is the beauty of flight and the elegance of the machines that he is building that allow people to take flight. It is the story of a marriage. It is the story of the relationship between a man and his country. It is the story about the relationship between a man and his job. And all of these elements sort of cohere to make the portrait of a guy who was so single-minded and so devoted to this beautiful, elegant idea that got away from him. Mm. It also doesn't focus as much as you might expect on his regret over how his machines were used.
ピラミッドの世界とどちらが好きかね。ピラミッドですか。空を飛びたいという人類の夢は呪われた夢でもある。飛行機は殺戮と破壊の道具になる宿命を背負っているのだ。はい。それでも私はピラミッドのある世界を選んだ。君はどちらを選ぶね。僕は美しい飛行機を作りたいと思っています。
It spends most of its energy sort of describing his hope for what he was building. And it also spends a lot of energy on just sort of telling the story of this man's life and how he devoted himself to this one small singular thing. And it doesn't destroy him, it just consumes him.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting, I would say, counterpoint to something like Oppenheimer, as opposed to like being a better version of the same story. I'm not trying to like sort of put one thing over another. I just think whereas that movie kind of deals in a more materialistic, for lack of a better word, dissection of its story, where it's like, here are the specific events that happened. This is a bit more dreamlike. It's a bit more ephemeral. It takes its energy from mood, from more from feel, from this idea that two things can exist in him at the same time. Whereas sort of Nolan's movie is more of a straight biopic. This is sort of an anomalous film in Miyazaki's oeuvre, so to speak. And like his movies tend to have like more of a fantasy element. And this does have some elements of fantasy, but they're more about like
what he's imagining.
What he's imagining, things like that. This is more grounded. It also has just some of the most beautiful animation you're ever going to see. Mm. I was lucky enough to see this at the Cinerama many years ago when it came out, and it was just amazing. This is a great film. You know, every time Miyazaki puts a new movie out, he's like, this is my last one. And then immediately he's like, well, I'm making another one. And
he's got
a new one coming out this year that I haven't seen yet, but I'm really excited about. At the time, this was his last movie. And if it had been his swan song, my God, what a way to go out. Anyway, check out The Wind Rises, especially if you liked Oppenheimer, and I'm not saying you shouldn't.
I have a very, very sweet, sweet movie to talk about next. It's Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret. Got to be together like birds of a feather. You and I didn't have a lot of friends. Didn't have too much to say. And it came out this year.
I haven't seen this yet.
It's just wonderful.
Judy Blume, right?
Judy Blume wrote this book that so many women have read. I read it when I was a teen. You did?
Mm-hmm.
That's wonderful. And it's all about just this coming of age story of this young girl who just really wants to fit in, basically. And this movie is based on that. And it's the director, Kelly Fremon Craig, who did Edge of 17, which I also really loved.
With Haley Steinfeld? Mm-hmm. That was a good movie.
It was really great. It stars Rachel McAdams as the mom, and she is wonderful. Margaret, the girl, Abby Ryder Fortson, she is amazing in this. She just steals the show.
Please just let me grow and let me get my period. Let me just be normal and regular like everybody else. Just please, 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 please. Amen.
We got Kathy Bates as the loud Jewish grandma who lives in New York.
Hell yeah.
They move from New York to New Jersey and grandma still lives in New York and she's all pissed off.
I'm never gonna see you again.
Oh. Jesus.
Wow.
So dramatic all the time.
And then, as the father, we have a surprise Benny Safdie.
Heavy machinery? Ouch.
Be better if I take my shirt off, or it's too much?
Not for me.
Hello.
who is fantastic. He doesn't need to give anything. He doesn't give much, but he's Benny Safdie, and he's your nerdy Jewish dad. And I love him for it. Set in the 70s, about this girl who, like I said, they move from New York to suburban streets of New Jersey, where she has to make all new friends. She has to fit in.
I already know your name is Margaret, and you're in sixth grade. The real estate agent sent out like a tiny flyer about you to the whole neighborhood. It was like this big and it had your picture.
Oh, okay.
I'm Nancy. I'm in sixth grade too. Do you want to come over to my house and run under the sprinklers with me?
And all her and her girlfriends are all just like concerned with growing their boobs, getting their period, kissing boys.
Do you think any of us will look like that when we're 19?
We must! We must! We must increase our bust!
And it's just kind of like the school year. It starts at the middle of the summer and it goes through the school year of her just trying to fit in, trying to make friends, trying to figure out who she is, what her family means to her, what her life in New York is like and compared to her new life in New Jersey, her relationship with her mother, her relationship with her grandmother, all of this very, very sweet stuff. It's kind of framed in that she has to write a term paper on religion and she's not quite sure if she wants to be Christian like her mom. And of course her dad's Jewish, so she wasn't really sure which way to go. So it's her like also kind of exploring different religious aspects of her family and what that means to her. And it's so good and it's so sweet. And then we also get the side story of Rachel McAdams going from being an art teacher in New York to trying to be a PTA mom, like homemaker, and with all these really preppy, and so she's just like, what do I do?
And then we'll cut out little stars and recreate the night sky.
Oh, lovely.
how many stars would we need?
Oh, I was thinking 5 or 10,000. It shouldn't take us long. I've got some.
There's this ongoing thing where she just keeps not buying furniture for the living room because she's like, I don't know what I'm supposed to buy. And so at one point, Benny Safdie drags the lawn chair from the backyard into the living room and sets it up. And he's like, no, this is fine.
Oh, honey. Oh.
What?
I'm so sorry.
What?
I swear I'm gonna buy the furniture.
This is all I need. Look at it. Then look.
Oh, God.
No. Find me a couch that does this, okay?
And he leans it all the way back and has his TV dinner and
classic
stuff.
Classic dude.
Classic. It was really, really sweet. I felt it had a lot of heart. It was very effective. It made me tear up. It made me laugh. It gave me the feels. And it was just a really solid coming-of-age movie. And I thought it was super well done. Maybe it was a little corny, but I was in the mood for it. So I'm glad I checked this out.
Not very spooky.
Not very spooky, but that's what next episode's about.
Exactly.
So check out Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret.
This is always the tough bit. I can't even do this to this day. Okay. All right. Can I see? How's that feel?
I cannot wait to take it off.
Yeah. Welcome to womanhood.
What do you got for me?
So I got a movie that is one of my favorite movies of all time. Mm. One of the greatest movies ever made.
Yes.
Certainly top two or three of its decade.
Oh, wow. Okay.
A little bit of a deep cut, but if you know me, I talk about this movie a lot. And it's called Flooding with Love for the Kid.
Oh. I know about this. I know about this, but I still have never seen it.
I love this movie.
Anyone who sees this movie loves it.
Scarecrow, a lot of Scarecrow staff are obsessed with this movie. That's how I heard about it.
I introduced this movie to us, FYI.
This is a Matt original.
This is a Matt original. Anyway, so let's start at the beginning. The movie First Blood, starring Sylvester Stallone.
I'm familiar.
The first Rambo film.
Have seen it.
Great film. A lot of people don't remember that it's based on a novel by a writer named David Morrell.
Good book.
Exactly. So, many, many years after First Blood, a young gentleman named Zachary Oberzan, an aspiring actor, performance artist, he decides he's going to readapt First Blood. Not remake First Blood, he's going to readapt the novel First Blood.
Okay, based on the source.
Based on the source material. And he's going to shoot the whole movie for less than $100 in his studio apartment in New York, and he's going to play every part. What follows is an hour and 47 minutes of cinematic purity. It is an untouchable piece of creativity. Nobody else could have made this film. It's beautiful, brilliant, and I will also say this. I love First Blood. First Blood doesn't make me cry. This movie makes me cry when it's over. You see past its intentional artifice, its lack of resources. You see the pure focus of an artist doing something that only he could do.
How do you know I was at the Chosen Reservoir?
Before I left Fort Bragg, I called Washington and had your file read to me. I had to. I had to understand what kind of man you were, in case this trouble with Rambo was your fault. In case you were after blood now, so I could anticipate any trouble you might give me. That was one of your mistakes with him. You went after a man you didn't know anything about.
Oberzan may not be the best actor in the world. Again, he has to play like 50 parts in this movie, and some of them have goofy wigs, some of them have silly accents.
What a surprise! We haven't heard from you in so long.
There are times when he's supposed to be driving a car, and it's him sitting in a chair in his kitchen, like holding a pizza pan as a steering
wheel. Dude, I love the effort.
There are parts where he's supposed to be flying a helicopter, and it's him sitting in a chair in his kitchen with a box fan over his head spinning around, because it's a helicopter now.
Of course.
There's a famous scene in First Blood where Sylvester Stallone is hanging off the side of the cliff. In this movie, it's Zach Oberzan hanging off the side of his bunk bed. When they're chasing him through the woods and he buries himself in mud, in Zach Oberzan's version, he gets into the bathtub and covers himself with towels.
This is DIY filmmaking at its purest.
At its purest, it's transcendent. You start out kind of being surprised, but at a certain point you start to wonder, like, how's he gonna do this stuff? And it becomes more and more exciting and more funny and more emotionally engaging with every single step. And within all this, like, say what you want about his acting skill, although I think he's pretty good in big chunks of it. Say what you want about where he decides to allocate his resources and how and what it looks like. It looks like what it looks like. And I think that that's a big part of its aesthetic. I think that that's important.
Like, the undertaking
that it looks like
itself
that way
is what's admirable.
All of it's extraordinarily admirable. But when you boil it all down, it's completely guileless. You can sit there and laugh at it. And I've interviewed him, and he is like, it's fine with me if people think that this is funny. He doesn't think that it's funny. He's not doing it as a joke.
Yeah.
It is 100% sincere. And that is why, by the time that it's over, you have been on a journey with these characters. You have been watching this story. It is not a joke. And I have put this movie in front of audiences. I have put this movie in front of my friends. It's a masterpiece. It's maybe the best movie of the 2000s. It's so good.
Yeah.
And also, I've been out of contact with Zach for a little while. This movie's not easy to see. However, you can track him down on the internet. He's still selling this, not on physical media, of course. And so I know this is a Viva physical media show, but you can rent or buy this on Vimeo. the money goes directly to him. So if you want to see it and you don't have access to a physical copy, I highly encourage you to go rent it or buy it from Vimeo and watch it, because you will not be disappointed.
And you'll be supporting
it
him.
It is a masterpiece. Flooding with Love for the Kid is one of the best movies I've ever seen in my life. The end.
Bark, bark, bark.
Woof, woof, woof.
All right. You know what that means. That means it's time for our dog movie, and we have an urban tale of loss and love.
A little bit of comfort food after the last few.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
It's Homeward Bound 2, Lost in San Francisco. As you may recall, Matt's first ever dog movie on the show was Homeward Bound 1.
Was that my first
one? Yeah, because me and Kevin did the original Incredible Journey, and then for the transition, you and I did the remake.
I feel like there was one before that, but you must be right.
I must be, because I am. Surprising, they got all the voice actors for this
except for Don Ameche, who was dead.
Yeah, and that sucks, too.
That's a big problem.
Because
here.
He died, but also because... Whoever
Ralph Waite, who is a very good actor.
He's bringing nothing to the table. He's bringing nothing.
Let's just say he's not filling the shoes
as well
as he could.
Let's just say I didn't even think Shadow would still be alive after all this. We hear him in the first one be like, I'm too old. And then this one, he's literally just like, he like doesn't know what the fuck's going on.
My gosh, sure is a lot happening this morning.
He's fucking Joe Biden-ing all over the place in this movie, to be honest.
Let's go Shadow.
Let's go Shadow.
This movie was fine. It doesn't have it doesn't have the spirit. It doesn't have the economy, the simplicity of the first one.
But it's enjoyable and it is sweet.
Enjoyable. It's a little bit too much of a let's make this a adventure kids movie thing. Yeah. I was watching this going, you're not living up to Beethoven here.
But I can tell that kids would still have a good time with it for sure. It's 3 years later, so this is 1996. It's directed by David R. Ellis. You may know him from such movies as Final Destination 2 or The Final Destination.
Or Cellular.
That's another good one.
I believe Snakes on a Plane.
Oh my God. This man has range.
Yeah.
And he delivered a solid little family film.
Yeah.
We got Michael J. Fox back as Chance in the role he was meant to play.
All right, trespasser, say your prayers. You have got a date with the Jensenator.
He's kind of really annoying this one, though.
I would say the same thing about Sally Field as Sassy.
Means the family's leaving, though who could blame them? The way you smell.
Yeah, she's everyone's kind of, they like wore out their original.
I think that the writing, it's too forced.
Yeah, it's like, oh, Chance is like an overeager, playful pup. And then they go like too hard with it.
I'm getting something on the old nose radar. That smells like sugar. Oh, please be sugar, be sugar, be sugar. It is sugar. It's sugar and chocolate and gold, deep fried and bubbling fat. It is. It's donuts.
Yeah. And then they're like, oh, Sassy's like really sarcastic and like kind of bitchy.
She's kind of mean.
Jeez, take a hint already.
Huh? What do you mean, take a hint?
Jamie's gonna send you back to the bad place. I'll miss you. Bye-bye.
There's no my boys moment?
Yeah, not really. And the kids are indifferent.
Well, Jamie's kind of a dick at the beginning.
No chance. No chance. No chance.
Aren't you gonna say goodbye to Chance?
See you later.
Just, all right. It's so contrived. It's like, well, we need to have a sequel and we're just going to like throw it together.
We get an intro by Chance. They are in their new home that they were moving to in the last one in Northern California. Mm-hmm. And their family is going on a camping trip.
We're going to Canada, boy. We're taking you with us.
Go. I'd go anywhere with you, Peter.
Well, we can't leave our pets at home. Last time we did that, this crazy thing happened. So we're going to take our pets with us on a
flight
to Canada.
First of all, let me ask you a question. Okay, so I would never go camping anyways because I don't want to.
Mm-hmm.
However, if you lived in Northern California and you wanted to go...
Camping
in Canada, wouldn't you just drive? Why would you fly?
It's a long-ass drive.
It's not that long. It's like 2 days.
Yeah, that's a long drive, Matt.
With a couple of...
I still think it's crazy to fly three animals halfway across the continent for some camping trip.
Well, if we're going, just let me use the litter box first.
Like you said in the text, these guys are bad at having pets.
They're really bad at having pets.
So first off, Jamie, the little boy, Chance's boy, is so annoyed at Chance, and like, I don't blame him.
Why?
Well, I know none of us likes to hear the B word, but that is one bad dog.
But I don't. If he heard how Chance was talking,
I guess. But why is he so mad at him?
He's just being annoyed because Chance is following him around because he loves him. Like,
I get annoyed at my dog because she barks at me when she wants to play ball.
No, but that just means she loves you.
Anyway, I can't get that annoyed.
Like a fickle little like 6-year old boy, and so he's kind of being mean. And Chance is like, wow, like Jamie is like blah blah blah.
Come on, honey, we're late. Let's go. Let's go.
It's Chance's fault. We chased him all over the park.
Oh, come on, Jamie, don't be mad at me, pal.
And then they pack them all up and they drive to the San Francisco airport where there's no rules because they just like put these dogs and cats.
It's pre-9/11.
Pre-9/11, literally they like...
You could strap a bomb to one of these dogs.
Yeah, you could have.
And of course the dogs
freak out. Chance especially freaks out and is like, we're going to the bad place. Yeah. He's always concerned with, he has anxiety.
A cage! They're treating me like I'm some kind of an animal.
I mean, he's convinced that he's going to be murdered at any given moment.
You'll never take me alive. I'm busting out of here. There's got to be a way out.
He shakes his crate off of the trolley thing that's leading them to the wherever they store pets on flights.
The cargo hold.
Yeah.
And then Shadow and Sassy are like, well, I guess we have to do that, too.
And then they're just running free through the airport. And then at one point, Shadow's like, I know they're in this plane. Let's just lay in front of the plane and they'll stop.
They're not stopping.
Hold tight.
They're not stopping.
They'll stop.
They're not stopping.
Oh.
That was kind of funny. And they all like laid down and the plane wasn't stopping and they all like cover their faces. It was kind of cute. So now these guys are in San Francisco.
They're lost in San Francisco. Hence the title.
And I believe someone says, oh yeah, once the family finds out.
You kids and your mom go camping. You have a good time.
But Dad, we won't have fun knowing the animals are lost in San Francisco.
Oh boy.
At first they're having a great time. At one point, Chance even calls himself Rap Master Chance.
You're on Rap Master Chance and I'm lost in the city with an optimistic dog and a sarcastic kitty.
They meet some friends.
They meet some strays.
They meet some strays.
First, they meet Ashcan and Pete.
We know where we're going every step of the way.
Hey, punk, watch it. Woohoo!
Hey, both. What's all the ruckus?
Yo, Pete, these runs just trespassed on our turf.
Yeah.
These MVPs.
These guys are bad boys of the streets.
Yeah, 100%. I'm going to look up the voice cast on my phone. Ashcan is John Polito.
I'm a Brother Seamus.
Brother Seamus? Like an Irish monk?
What the fuck are you talking about?
Okay.
From like Miller's Crossing and like, yeah, you know who John Polito is. Trust me. And then there's, it's Adam Goldberg.
There's no library in this town. Why is there no library in this town?
Oh, okay. That's funny. And they're like your bumbling thugs, yes. You know? And then this other gang comes to kind of like get them off the backs of Chance and Shadow and Sassy. And
I hope you're not making threats, trash can.
Unless you want to wake up at the vets
with a thermometer under your tail.
They're led by Riley, voiced by Sinbad.
Sinbad.
Don't you know this place ain't safe for no pets?
There's also a girl dog named Delilah.
Hey, odd stuff, why don't you butt out?
You're looking to get fixed.
Who?
Carla Gugino.
So you guys didn't bone?
Yeah, oh yeah.
She's a kuvaz.
She is like so street smart and beautiful and really likes Chance, and her and Chance kind of hit it off. She kind of shows Chance the city, and Chance is like, whoa, maybe I can be a city dog, like a stray city dog. Yes. I don't need owners. And they're kind of the mindset that humans are bad.
Chance, stay clear of those humans. You can't trust them.
Come on, what's not to trust? You're talking about the species that invented the chili cheeseburger.
Chance is like, let's go to this restaurant. We can probably find food. There's humans here. And they're like, humans suck.
Yeah.
We find out it's because one of the reasons is they do a flashback to Sinbad's Riley.
They tied a ribbon to his collar and they put him in a big basket underneath a tree. But the little boy,
He didn't seem to like Riley very much.
And so he was put out on the street on the coldest, rainiest night.
It's horrible.
It's really sad.
I have a real issue with this kind of storytelling.
Because it makes you sad?
Yeah. So there's like, you could have a school of thought that's like, well, it's too contrived. Obviously, it's pushing my buttons. Like, meant to make me sad. But also, as the owner of a beautiful dog, when I watch that stuff, it makes me angry.
Yeah.
Because what kind of monster abandons their dog?
Yeah. I got like in my feelings. I was in an Uber in Austin and I was looking around and I was like, Louise was like walking these streets. I was just like, she was just
That's
like,
right. She was from Austin.
I was like, she was just like walking next to that like taco truck. Like, yep. And she was just, and I'm like, she loves everybody. So she was just like walking by herself.
Looking for snacks.
I got so sad.
Yeah.
Anyways, so basically Chance and Delilah are having their urban adventure while Shadow and Sassy, and Shadow is just like nonstop, let's go, Sassy, we can do it.
The sooner we get moving, the faster we reach home.
Don't worry, home is right across the bridge. Like all, he's literally just like dead. He's dead inside. He's dead inside. He has no personality.
I think Michael J. Fox's improvs are really bad in this too. And I also think that when his romance with Delilah is just bad.
But Delilah, I thought, what about me?
Who are you?
I'm her. I mean, I was gonna be her.
Ah, Bando, face it. You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
Bando, I told you, you and I are just friends.
Huh?
Yeah, and but this movie isn't bad. It's just the first one was so, I felt like the first one worked so well and it really was heartfelt.
The first one's light, it's economical.
But then it's also there's stuff at risk, like Sassy in the river,
yes.
And like the porcupine quills and Chance, and everyone's kind of funny, and everyone, I don't know, it had more heart and there was more at risk. And this one, they're just like,
they seem genuinely confounded by their dilemma in the first one. And this one, they're just like, well, we're here.
And of course we have the two bad guys who are looking to steal
the bad dog catchers. And it's Max Perlick.
Yes.
And Jackie, is it Jackie? Jackie April from The Sopranos?
I don't remember the actor's name.
I may be acting boss while the old man's a guest of the government, but I wish somebody to tell my bowels because they don't obey.
They're trying to find dogs to, like, sell. Like, they're not even, like, taking them to the pound.
And they're in the blood-red van.
They call them the blood-red van.
They take them to the lab. They sell them to the lab.
Run them over.
Jack, that's about another $100 worth of dog out there.
I mean, all these kind of dog movies have the bad, like, I wrote pound operators because I don't remember, like, what's it called?
Pound operator. Coast to coast,
LA to Chicago.
Okay.
All right. To Lost in San Francisco. At one point, Sassy's like, oh, I know how to get food.
Oh. First, you bound up acting like you really want to see him, then make your cautious approach.
Hi.
Yes, Susan, my furlong.
And I thought this was kind of cute. She's like, you run up to him really fast, and then you pretend to be shy. And then Chance is like, okay, shit, I'll do that. And he's a fucking, like, bulldog. And he, like, runs up. And, of course, the guy runs back inside. But then later, the house is on fire. And guess who the hero is? Guess who has a fucking death wish?
Shadow. Yeah. He rescues the boy and then Sassy rescues the kitten.
Yeah. And she's like, gross. And she has the kitten in her mouth. I thought that was kind of funny. And that is one of the scenes that I remember from being a kid.
It's cute.
And then they're just like, thanks. Shadow's like, that's it? Like a thanks?
This really terrible, they try to recreate the emotional power of the fake out ending in the first one where you think Shadow didn't make it. And he doesn't get to come home.
So yeah, eventually they get across the bridge and they think they're leaving Chance behind. They think Chance and Delilah, Chance is going to have a new life.
Well, Chance won't come because he is too miserable without his new girlfriend,
and
Delilah.
And Shadow and Sassy are like, okay, he knows the way. He'll find us, whatever. And so they start headed across. They get across the bridge and like one more hill. And then they hear Chance and they're like, oh, Chance is coming.
Because he's just standing in the middle of the road.
And he's literally singing, I left my heart in San Francisco.
Yes.
I left my heart in San Francisco.
And then, uh-oh, this big semi-truck's coming.
Go!
Jackknifes.
Yeah, there's this big accident. But guess who's behind the semi-truck?
Well, it's the family.
It's the family in their car. And they get out and they see Shadow and Sassy. And they're like, what? They're actually not as, like, surprised as I would be if all of a sudden my lost animals
Like, what an insane coincidence.
Yeah, exactly. But then they start yelling for Chance. And Jamie's like, Chance! Chance!
Chance!
With his stupid little voice.
How's it go?
Chance! 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 And then the truck driver's like, I didn't see there's a dog. Oh, my God, blah, blah, blah.
And then he has to explain to his son.
Where's my dog?
Jamie.
He's like, well, the truck driver crashed because there were dogs in the road.
And so
the dog was Chance.
The boy flips out, runs.
No!
But then he looks under the truck and Chance is there. And I'm just a sucker for when they put their paws over their face.
Yes, that's very
it's
cute.
Very cute. So Chance is okay. Everyone's okay. And they go back to their home. Chance is a little sad, though.
He's heartbroken.
He's heartbroken.
And then Delilah shows up at the end. She's like, I guess she made her way back to their place.
She just she followed her nose. And they're all happy, and she meets the
it's
family.
Not her nose that she followed.
And then they're like, can we keep her? And everyone's like, sure.
Extra dog. We
we need
a third dog to lose for the next movie.
Yeah, exactly. One more dog. Well, you know, Shadow doesn't have that much time left. He's got to not have that much time left. I can't believe it. Can't believe that guy.
His Cobra payments are insane too.
And that's it. It's fine.
It's fine.
Sweet.
I'm gonna give this 2.5 paws.
I think that's a safe bet. Is 2.5
paws. It was cute.
Sure.
It's not bad.
Like if I was a kid, I would love it, and I did love it as a kid.
Yeah.
I think.
But it doesn't even come remotely close to the perfection of the original.
It doesn't have that special something of the original.
Doesn't.
Even with the same cast, it's like everyone was just kind of like, yeah, paycheck's fine from this.
Yeah.
You know. I mean, you got some San Francisco shots, if you're into that.
It looks good. It's well directed. The voice cast is generally pretty good, except for like Ralph Waite. I think he's like, it's not that he's bad. It's just he's not Don Amici.
He really isn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Shadow literally just
lost
his spark.
And I actually do think Sally Field is not doing as good of a job.
Yeah, you're right. And Michael J. Fox is like trying too hard.
Yeah. What are we doing next?
Okay, so next episode is going to be our
spooky
episode. And so you may remember that we did do the original, I believe it was like 1977, the pack.
The Robert Klaus film.
Yeah. And then we did something called The Breed that we almost got confused with this. But we are going to do the 2015 Australian remake of The Pack called The Pack.
So it's not just a clever name.
No. I think this might be fun. I don't know. I think I'm in the mood for it. I think it's supposed to be like a home invasion.
You know what my favorite thing about this is? 88 minutes.
Ooh, love it. That's refreshing.
Let's go.
Yeah, so stay tuned for that.
Who are you guys?
I'm Sparky Michaels.
I'm Lucky Lasorda.
And I'm Trixie Euchre, and we're broadcasting here.
Yeah, so move your tail, buddy.
Episode
65. Let's go.
We did it. I think it was great.
I think we did it.
You feeling relaxed and good about it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Doing good.
I think this is a great episode. I want to thank everyone for watching. Please share on your social media and like and subscribe. Give us a little hey in the comments. Vote for your Raunch versus Rom.
Please get a membership if you don't already have one.
It's such a good way to support something you love and care about.
Buy a ticket to a Scarecrow show.
Oh my God, you're going to have so much fun.
Please come to the store, or if you are far away, tune in to the live stream on Video Store Day.
It's going to be a party.
It's going to be a huge party.
It's going to be a huge party, and this place is really cool. I don't know if you know, but this place is really cool.
It's pretty cool. Please send us some mail.
Viva@scarecrow.com. 5030 Roosevelt Way, Northeast Seattle, Washington, 91005.
She knows what she's doing.
Follow us on all the things.
Yeah.
Say hi to us. Talk to us. Let us know.
Check
what
out
you're
our
watching.
New website, scarecrowvideo.org. Rent some movies by mail.
If you're doing the Psychotronic Challenge, tag us and
hashtag
SCV Psycho Challenge, what you're watching. Or if you want to just like email us and let us know like what you've been watching this horror season like any of your favorite like traditions you do. Or if you want to just show us your pet dressed up in a Halloween costume. Would love it.
We'd love that.
Or you, if you're dressing up in like a movie costume, I love seeing people's movie.
Especially
Halloween
if it's
costumes.
A dog costume.
If you're dressing up as a dog.
Like in The Shining.
Like in The Shining.
Just like that.
I don't want to see it. Don't show me. You can send Matt though.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Viva Physical Media 65. Let's go.
We'll see you later. Bye.
Super ninjas coming, faster than a bullet, leaping over buildings, waving at the children.
You must be sent up for space time.
D-D-D-D-J-J-J-J.
You must be sent up for space time.
D-D-D-D-J.
Unicum capra di meglar.
You are so fat, you explode your own pants.